Welcome to Computer Magic, a behind-the-scenes look at the new world of animation and special effects made possible by very special computer systems, the kind that create visual magic. What you're seeing now are examples of computer animation magic. During the show, you'll learn how these amazing effects are created. But first, here's a montage assembled from the works created by the host of our show, Robert Abel. Computers have become a powerful tool for creating visual images. This show will explore computer animation and special effects as they are used in television and for art. The animation and special effects you will see in this program were created, usually by adults, using these amazing new computer systems. Computer graphics, animation, and design have been expanding at an explosive rate. Visuals produced on computers are being used in many areas besides television. For example, computers are being used by architects to help design buildings, by hospitals to design artificial body parts, by interior decorators, package designers, factories, scientists, and even by shoe designers to more quickly and easily explore new designs. Practically every field that involves visual imagery is now being assisted by computers, a development which was surely undreamed of by the early computer pioneers. Recent breakthroughs have brought down the cost of advanced computer graphic systems to less than one-tenth of what they cost just a few years ago. However, highly advanced systems still cost well over $100,000. As advances are made in the field, many of the sophisticated abilities of the high-end systems are becoming available in systems costing about $30,000. But for those who want to own a truly state-of-the-art animation system, there is only one computer to consider, the Cray XMP. However, there are several things to consider before buying a Cray. They are rather large and bulky, they only come in one color, and they cost about $13 million. The major users of these systems are art production groups that create television and motion picture special effects. As you might imagine, the effects created on these systems tend to cost the clients a lot of money. For instance, companies that advertise on television sometimes pay more than $15,000 per second for computerized special effects. That's nearly $1 million for a 60-second commercial. There is a more accessible level of computer graphics and animation software available for home computers at a cost of about $30 and up, and the quality and value of these systems is improving rapidly. Although we can't fully explore all the ways that computers are being used to create visual effects, in the time we have available, we will take a behind-the-scenes look at how computers help create special effects for television, and we'll view some of the finest examples of computer animation from around the world.
Get all your fusion and fission needs at Botco, the number one name in high-energy fuels. Matter, antimatter, it doesn't matter at Botco. Our cheerful, speedy attendants can handle them all. Don't pay those expensive re-entry fees. We'll bring the widest variety of particles, subparticle, and theoretical energy fuels factory direct to you. Positrons, bosons, or diesel in astronomical quantities and down-to-earth prices that won't put a black hole in your wallet. Next door or across the universe. Botco. Tomorrow's fuels, tomorrow's prices.
Even in the year 3000, the question will be, what's for dinner?
Commercials are as much a part of our popular culture as movies and television, perhaps because the best commercials provide the same kind of entertainment. This is the story of the making of the commercial called Brilliance. An extraordinary look at a very ordinary product. Created by Ketchum Advertising, it was produced by Robert Abel and Associates.
Felt we wanted to do something that was so image-oriented and so striking that you kind of dispelled all the rumors about cans that you know. And we came up with a presenter who we like to call HM, and a rather simple board of eight frames to tell a very simple story of what's for dinner.
When we saw this board, I said, we've got to do this board. Because, and at the same time I'm saying this, I'm scared because I don't know if we can do the board. So this, you know, this is a classic story of a commercial that can't and shouldn't be made. But it's like the little engine that could, and we're gonna do it.
Well, people have a preconceived idea of what computer commercials look like, and this is gonna break out of all of those molds. I mean, it's a real step, it's a quantum leap as far as commercials.
The reason we chose Randy Roberts to direct this thing was that Randy has done so much work that we always thought was impossible, and he always proved us wrong.
Yeah, it's this kind of detail, this early space vehicle. Yeah, because it kicks light up well, and that's another thing we'll have to experiment with is the way some of these surfaces are affected by light.
The first step was to translate that two-dimensional image that we see on the storyboard into one that works in three dimensions in the computer. And that takes a lot more redesign than it looks at first glance, because we had to build the robot and her environment in pieces. It means everything from the smallest finger joint to the torso to the neck to the body parts, the leg, the arm, 18 pieces had to be put together and created for the computer. This entire image really never existed outside the computer itself.
And so you chose on her, instead of the helmet, to just kind of go with one piece, sort of, it looks a little more like almost Egyptian.
Yeah, the thing with that is, in order to get this type of a helmet on, it has to be back on the head and tilted. And it's like when you do that here, it looks like a woman sitting under a hairdryer.
Once we had the design, we used a foam mannequin to give real shape to the robot. The foam was sliced into cross sections, and each outline was then programmed and fed digitally into the computer and stored as information.
How's that?
That's pretty good. Okay, now the bottom lip looks a little thick. Maybe we should
Can I translate them all up a little?
Yeah, maybe from like 25 to 34 or something. Okay. Well, I think that looks better.
It has to be something where you really can't tell if she's real or if she's computerized. Her movements are very human, and she's very sexy but very strong. And you really, you've got to believe it's a human being, yet it isn't quite. It just couldn't be with the way, the look of her body.
The biggest unknown was making her move, bringing her to life. Randy invented a technique he called brute force animation. We filmed a live model and programmed her choreographed movements into the computer. The computer tracked reference points painted on her body and created a stick figure animation, which we call a vector graphic.
The motion is all set up hierarchical so that wherever we move her torso, her arms all go with it in addition to the motion of the body, so that it has more of the characteristics of the way her body motion is, the way it accelerates and decelerates, and the way it holds at the right places and when things start and stop.
Once we got the motion right, we used raster graphics to give the image form and color. The robot, her movements, the details, each reflection, the magic she does with the food, getting all of that into an environment and then adding Jupiter into the picture window. Well, that's millions of bits of information that the computer has to chew through. If you can imagine, each picture of film, which is a 24th of a second, takes 10,000 or 20,000, add, multiply, subtracts, divides. And on top of this, we're writing new software on a daily basis to speed this up. You get an idea that we're combining some science and technology with the ultimate in improvisation.
What happened here? What is this her reflection?
That's before the reflection program was fixed.
Okay, so this is a composite frame that we've already saved.
Put it together now.
Oh, okay.
In the last month, we put three computers online around the clock to ensure the fact that we'd make that Super Bowl due date. Because we could output directly to one-inch videotape, we could literally take images off the computer and hand carry them to the edit session in stages.
Well, the thing that holds up is the joints. That's why this was...
Naturally, we're incredibly proud of the results. But you get so close to an actor or to a performance, or in this case, to our friend that we called Sexy Robot, that we, in the Catch'em advertising group, just held our breath as we showed it to the client.
Even in the year 3000, the question will be, what's for dinner? The answer will be in a package that saves energy, nutrients, and trouble. A package that can last the 3-year journey to Jupiter and back and back and back. Even in the year 3000, we see the brilliance of food in cans.
Sometimes the large production groups that create commercials take time out to practice their skills in flights of fancy. These works are usually seen only by prospective clients. Here is a rare glimpse at computer animation that is not normally seen by the public. Thank you. This piece was created by linking 108 Apollo computer workstations together to share the incredible workload. As a result of linking many workstations together, it was possible to put over 52,000 hours of labor into the film in only 6 weeks. The piece demonstrates the illusion of refracted light and rippling water, as well as sophisticated textures and computer-generated sound. The story is about a character who comes from a monochrome universe and travels in search of color and dimension. The character was created using the shapes that make up the Apollo computer logo, and he is able to change his shape to accommodate different modes of travel. The story is an analogy of the history of the Apollo computer system. Both the character in the story and Apollo computers began in a two-dimensional graphics world and moved into a world of three-dimensional color images.
How do you do computer graphics? And believe me, I'm an engineering school dropout. You make them user-friendly is the key. I'm going to give you a little sample here right now of how we build an object before your eyes and my eyes, and this is just the way it's done in the studio, of how you build something. Now we start with a little cone and a ball. And we say, okay, that's good. You know, OJ&C spot run. It looks like Sesame Street. But to make it three-dimensional, we add a light source. Again, this is done before our eyes on something called the Rastertech monitor. Now we put a light source, specular highlights. The blue guys are reflections. It's beginning to look a little real. Now put it in an environment and say that it's going to be reflected using a reflection technique, and this thing begins to really look real. Now I'm going to give you 7 seconds, three times, of a little test that we did for Hoover Vacuum. We were first putting this job together. And this all happened within a week's period of time, and it happened before the eyes of the client. In order to get this, we simply pick colors. We use our eyes just like you do. We make up a table that's somewhere between 6,000 and 16 million colors. So when Kenny Merman says, I want that blue, that's got a number in the table. And we use our little friend Ava here to model our colors for us. We can change colors as fast as you're seeing them happen here. And it happens on a video screen. You can take it away with you. You can see it. You can change it. We can ship it to you. The fact is that it's all under your control. And being in control, I got to tell you, is a good feeling. So now we add her parasols. We change their patterns. We can give her any combination that we want. Now, to get it down real simple, let's do a rock. Now, it's a diagram of the rock. Let's make it 3D. We add these polygonal shapes, and it becomes 3D. We decide we want to put a skin over it, of course, to make it more rock-like, and we add the skin. And now we want to do is to give it a marbleized surface or texture. Now, Kenny Merman is working at one of these Raster Tech units. He simply scans on this marbleized unit, and then he says, well, I'm going to select from this palette. I'm going to go in with my little electronic pencil, and I'm going to pick a kind of a magenta red here, and I'm going to paint some more because I want to see more. So here, blown up 40 times, is actually what Kenny and the client see in real time as he enhances it. Now, texture mapping wraps it around the rock. We paint a blue sky on our paint system, paint in some clouds, put in a little ground plane, and digitally put that rock back up in the sky. So when it moves through the sky, it looks like this. And, of course, Kenny has to work night and day to do this, sort of, but he's got white shoes here to help him. And the end spot is a commercial that looks like this.
A new idea, like a pebble in a pond, can change the world around it. Technology from a company called TRW puts ideas to work. And when an idea gets going, there's no end to where it can lead. Tomorrow is taking shape at a company called TRW. First, someone gets an idea. Then someone else may look at it differently, even add a thought or two. Technology from a company called TRW helps ideas get around. Because getting an idea from one place to another is as important as getting an idea. Did you ever notice that just when you think you see the whole picture, the picture changes? Technology from a company called TRW lets us look at our world in fresh ways. Because there's more to everything than meets the eye. You have to draw the line someplace. Then, cross over it. That's how new ideas start. How new worlds open up. Technology from a company called TRW helps chart new worlds. Today, we draw the line where it has never been before. Tomorrow, we'll cross over it. Tomorrow is taking shape at a company called TRW.
In a moment, we'll explore other ways that computers are used to create special effects, and we'll see a variety of approaches to creating computer animation. But first, let's enjoy a montage assembled from the works of one of the pioneers in the field of computer visual effects, Cranston Surrey Productions. We'll be right back. Here's a look at how Cranston, Surrey approaches the task of creating a computer animation commercial. After the ideas for the piece are decided upon and a storyboard is created, work on the animation can begin. Production begins with the creation of data for the animation. Each object appearing on the storyboard must be translated into the computer as numerically defined, three-dimensional data. Generation of this data is automated through specially designed software.
Through the storyboard process, we came up with a style of glasses that we wanted to use in the spot. Searching around, we found somebody that had those very same glasses. By taking the outline, looking just primarily at the shape of the glasses, we can then pull off a line drawing, which I've done here, which is the first step in setting up three-dimensional data. By creating this line drawing, I can then digitize around it or trace around it with the puck or cursor here on the computer and input the data into the computer initially.
Once the object is in the computer, it can be manipulated and distorted. Data can be built in pieces and combined to create a single object. When the three-dimensional objects are in the computer, an animator is ready to begin the motion. Vector or wireframe devices and motion programs are available to implement motion testing. Special motion software allows an animator to arrange objects and viewpoints according to the key frames of a storyboard.
What we need to do is build a large cluster of gears, approximately 65 gears. And the eye point will be starting from here and moving along over the top of this cluster, and you notice it's ever widening, so you get more and more gears.
While developing a vector motion test, color and lighting are created and added to the scene. The client receives full resolution still images from this test to evaluate the data, color, and lighting. The software team researches and develops new programs to accomplish special effects as shown by the simulation of refraction.
The added dimension of the reflection of the window on the front of the glasses helps give the appearance of actual glass present in the lens, which wasn't really there with just the changed image.
A camera digitizer can be used to input visual textures. Once the texture has been recorded, it can be placed on almost any object. Animators integrate color and lighting to create a color motion test called a low resolution test. For time and cost efficiency, frames are calculated at a lower resolution, using only a small portion of the screen. The images appear blocky because a small portion of the screen is enlarged, revealing individual pixels within the image. As frames are enlarged to full screen and viewed in rapid succession, a client for the first time sees the color, motion, and timing of the final animation. The client approves the color motion test and full resolution stills, and final calculations begin. An animation is calculated as one picture, or as separate layers that can be composited. With separate layers, it's possible to composite with different background colors. These frames are recorded electronically and transferred to video with the flexibility of forward, reverse, and several different speeds. If the animation is to be delivered on film, it is transferred to a recording system where 35mm motion picture film or 4x5 still transparencies are shot. Still frames are produced from the final animation. These images are then able to be used for editorial coverage, print, promotion, and advertising. From the development of a concept to the final recording of an animation, Cranston, Surrey, together with its clients, are expanding the frontier of special effects by channeling imagination and inventiveness into computer-generated animation.
A good idea by itself may go nowhere. It needs other good ideas. Technology from a company called TRW makes the most of ideas by helping them work together. And working together is the best idea in the world. Tomorrow is taking shape at a company called TRW.
Fully explore the ways computers are being used to help create music videos.
Now, the commercial I'm going to show you coming up next was created at Needham. What this appears to be here is an average helicopter flight over an average city. But in fact, these are, as this little sign says, all miniatures. In fact, it's a lot of miniatures created on a 50 by 60 foot stage in a period of about 8 weeks. Here's a close-up of some of those miniatures. The scale, for those of you who are into model railroad trains, is half HO gauge. There's something like 1,500 cars, 3 miles of fiber optics. I think we made about 6,500 different little houses, 7,000 trees. And here, of course, is our old friend, the computerized camera. The movement, we went through something like 17 different movements to figure out the exact movement, was all controlled by the computer, which we then videotaped. When we had to build these buildings in section, we started with the girders and with the frame, and we'd build up a building. Then we'd replace that building with the solid form of the building, as you see here in the white. We went into the office, and they said, this is a view of a town. It's a small town. It's 1950s. This is the storyboard that we had to work with, all that we work with, and this is the beauty of the thing. And they said, we want to see a town like this grow before our eyes so that we can see something between, say, 1950 and 1985 in 60 seconds grow before our eyes. We want the church, the hardware store, the little square, all that stays, but the new building grows around it. Can you do it? We said, yeah, we can take that world and we can make it into a brand new world. Of course, we're going to have to replace about 700-800 buildings and put in all these cars and fiber optics, but hey, piece of cake. How long you got? 8 weeks. Well, the rest is kind of history. So at this particular point, let's move forward and look at some more tape. Again, we're using our old friend, the computer preview system. The blue buildings are already existing, but the red buildings are, in fact, the new buildings that have to go in. So we could tell in preview, and again, we did many different versions of these things, sometimes one or two a day, but the buildings that had to go in and when they had to go in, how big they had to be so they didn't block other buildings was, again, all figured out on that amazing computer preview system. Once we got to that step, we made styrofoam and balsa mock-ups. So this is part two. And if you listen and hear in the background, you'll hear the moviola. We're running this as live film that we shot on the set. So everything was very carefully rehearsed in advance. And finally, of course, is the finished commercial.
Imagine designing a telephone system for a city that doesn't exist yet.
Hello, Bart. Wait, you're there.
How do you design a telephone system for some place where more and more people and businesses are moving in? Not just a phone system to handle more people talking, but lots more data and video transmission. How can any phone company keep up? The people of ITT have created a unique telephone system to answer just such a need. ITT System 12. System 12 is an extraordinary digital system engineered to serve even the smallest town and expand easily and economically, even as that town becomes a big city. ITT System 12 is designed to meet tomorrow's needs, the needs that don't even exist yet.
It took 6 months to produce this 30-second commercial for Australian television.
Let me show you a special effects commercial now that we did that uses every trick we ever knew how to do.
The most advanced production car on the planet is now called Corvette. Chevrolet is taking charge.
Now, what you see there was a strange thing. That was a real car, but that was kind of a wireframe diagram of a real car, too, but they matched up exactly. The key, or the trick to that, is a computer system we developed a long time ago that allowed clients to see whether their commercial was live action or miniature or otherwise, an exact architectural preview in 3D and in real-time movement of what that car was going to look like. Just like a blueprint is drawn by an architect for his very expensive client, we draw blueprints in motion for our very expensive clients, too. So what we use here is a preview method. Knowing how this thing is going to look in preview helps. But let me now take you back through the stages. I'd like to show you, first of all, the storyboard that we use for this commercial. Now, if you notice, it says, and in fact, take a look, 101 separate drawings. All graphics, it says at first. That means we're going to do that in computer graphics. Then it says 8x10. That's right, an 8x10 photo to shoot that. Now we're going live. Shoot front, side, and back. Come up and over the car. Now we're into live action. We're going to go to a high angle, rear, over the driver. So this is, again, the continuity broken down, reflections in the windshield. Because that car is not going to be in a real space. It's going to be in an artificial space that we created. Shift, cut, point of view. In order to go fast in a 200 by 200 foot environment, we're going to have to move quickly. Wipe that car past the car. Mount a camera, 20 millimeters. Wipe it past camera. Environment in the helmet, front projection. From the driver's POV, hyperspace, little George Lucas here as the car roars by. Now it's going into a tunnel. Now the key to this tunnel is that it doesn't exist. It exists in this computer that you see Steve Cooney working at here. The whole feeling of this tunnel, because we didn't have $75,000 to build one, was to create one for a small fraction of that price here in this computer. Oh, a car in a tunnel, but it's not in the tunnel. What we did is we made a little black replica of the car that you saw, and we put it in there. And then we took the computer graphics that we created and we front projected it back on the car a la 2001. So now you see the car in the tunnel and it looks totally real. My God, modern science. And here, finally, is the full commercial.
It began as genius and grew to be legend and has become at long last the most advanced production car on the planet. You've never seen. A new Chevrolet Corvette like never before. Never before. A Corvette superb in its engineering and technology and defiant in its performance. You've never felt anything like this before. Feel the performance of the world's first computer-activated manual transmission. Never before. A Corvette with never before available unidirectional turbine fin wheels and tires individually engineered for all four corners. You've never seen anything like this before. Liquid crystal displays, 14 separate instrument readouts, English or metric, all updated 16 times every operating second. You've never heard an available Delco Bose stereo with four never-before speakers, separately engineered for sound that's out of this world. Never before. The most advanced production car on the planet is now called Corvette. Chevrolet is taking charge.
Works like this Greg Kinn music video are created using a unique kind of computer system that not only helps create animation and graphics, but can also manipulate video images in practically endless ways. One such highly developed system is the Quantel Paint Box. Its abilities are amazing, as you'll see in this demonstration by Positive Video. Is a video computer graphics system with such high resolution that the images it produces can look as lifelike as a photograph or as abstract as your imagination. It's the modern video equivalent of all the traditional tools available to graphic artists. The system is operated through an electronic stylus or pen. A simple motion of the pen displays the paint palette. The right side of the palette shows the pen's point size and color. The left side shows a collection of artist-selected colors. To select new colors, one simply mixes the existing colors. The paint box has the capability of recreating traditional painting techniques, such as the textured effect of charcoal or chalk. The use of airbrush mode will do everything a traditional airbrush does, except drip. In addition, these systems have capabilities that conventional mediums don't have. For example, a mode that can alter the color of an area without affecting the underlying image. The system is configured for two hard disk drives capable of storing over 500 pictures in digital form. There is also a floppy disk drive, which can store an image onto an 8-inch diskette. An ability which sets the paint box apart from other imaging systems is its ability to instantly input and then manipulate a still frame of full-color video. Any video image, either from camera or tape, can be captured or frozen without any noticeable loss of picture quality. Then, all the functions of the system can be used to alter the image. You can magnify an area of the picture in order to do detail work. Colors can be selected right from the picture itself, allowing for perfect retouching. In some cases, matching a color isn't enough. Complex patterns can be duplicated to produce the needed effect. The full potential of the cut-and-paste ability quickly becomes apparent. By now, you've probably gotten the impression that the system can do just about anything with a still image. But what about animation? There are several ways the system can create animated effects. One of the simplest is through the use of what is called the animation package. To use it, you first cut out an area of the picture you wish to animate. The paint box automatically produces a series of cells. You can duplicate and move cells while keeping them in perfect registration. When the cells are completed, they are put in a stack. The stack is then replaced in the original image and run at any selected speed or sequence. By using the paste over feature, a stack or any cutout may be digitally keyed over live video, allowing perfectly clean, soft-edged keys. Another feature of the system is that a sequence of activity can be stored and then replayed at various speeds. Editing opens up even more possibilities. A more electronic approach is to prepare objects for manipulation by the Mirage or other digital effects systems. Finally, the combination of live action with paint box imagery provides the electronic equivalent of glass mat painting. For example, in the Greg Kinn music video, Reunited, the widest possible shot of the Oz set was this. But through computer magic, the set was made to appear much larger. The same technique was used in this program, and of course it's been used to expand the horizons of many productions. Perhaps you're wondering what the future holds for this new computer technology. Many experts in the field are predicting a time when computers will create full-length movies that appear normal in every respect, but are produced entirely on computers, using no actors, cameras, or locations. Other experts are claiming that photographic evidence is no longer to be trusted because of the computer's ability to perfectly retouch an image. Because these computer systems have become more accessible, a new generation of artists is producing art exclusively by computer. Coming up are some examples of computer-generated art. The piece you're seeing now is called Calculated Movements. This is a sample of the work of one of Japan's foremost computer artists. A highly advanced computer system was used that features a program that has the ability to simulate natural growth patterns.
Thank you. seems I'm not in anymore.
This work took over 2 years to produce and is considered to be the first successful simulation of a human form in computer animation.
Ah, I remember when everyone came to see Tony the Peltry. Nights were always too short. The ladies and I got along great. One look was all it took. À tous ces gens qui avaient toujours l'air contents. Pense à tous les soirs où j'étais joué du Mozart.
Viva l'amore!
We now end our show with a look at the opening of the TV series Amazing Stories. The producer's idea was to open with all the symbols and objects of storytelling from the beginning of time. The producer wanted 37 objects to fly by in 45 seconds. That's usually the number of objects used in 3 or 4 television commercials. The amount of work involved was almost unthinkable. Another problem was that even though the animation was being done for a famous movie producer, classically people who do feature films and television don't have the high production budgets that television commercials have.
So we had less money to do more work. I didn't know how we were going to do it.
We had 37 objects, even though they flew by quickly. Each was on about 4 seconds, and each one had to be rendered fully. We had people here 24 hours a day. It got insane. There were people sleeping here towards the end. We'd have shifts of people coming in the morning that wouldn't see the people that were working in the night. It was about 3 times harder than the sexy robot commercial we did.
The knight had to move in a lifelike fashion. The knight's elbows and wrists had to move along with his head and torso. Randy Roberts applied the technique he used for the robot, which was proved to be an effective way of translating movement into computer graphics. Developing a realistic-looking Olmec head image was another problem. It was solved by modeling a three-dimensional head and dividing it into segments. Using these segments, they fed coordinates into a three-dimensional digitizer. This rough data was then enhanced point by point by the computer system. The result was a stunning representation. The storyboards also called for a reappearing image of a flying book.
So I asked Randy, I said, how are you going to do the book? And he showed me this book of a pigeon in flight.
Various wing positions were picked and dialed into the computer. The books flew perfectly the very first try.
Now, of course, we already had too much work to do. And I'd see Randy and he'd say, but Bob, we just got to do this one more idea. It wasn't enough that he had made books fly. Now he wanted additional background images.
I want to put this in behind the flying book sequence. Against black, you could be flying up, down, sideways, you don't even know. This way we can fly through this cathedral and you'll get a sense of perspective.
Just look at this book for a minute. The binding is real alligator leather. The inside is real typography of Charles Dickens' Christmas Carol. Every object in Amazing Stories has textures and highlights. Like the skull, you can't tell the difference between the real skull and the one we've created with raster imagery. Even when you don't see all the details, you can sense them. And that's what makes great computer graphics.
The level of detail that was accomplished went beyond everyone's expectations. The producer had set a very high standard because he wanted it to be finished on feature film, not videotape. On 35mm film, every detail was sharp, computed at double the normal resolution. As a result, the work is the closest yet to Disney quality animation.
Thank you.
lot of things to be learned in an experience like this. You don't have to be Steven Spielberg to get amazing-looking computer graphics. But thanks to Steven and Amazing Stories, each week 40 or 50 or 60 million Americans are going to get a great taste of what great computer graphics can look like. That's important because we've always talked about a future when a mass audience was going to start absorbing computer graphics. Well, that future that always seems so distant is here, and it's now.